Good now. I hope you're doing well. Whoever and wherever you are across the world, thank you very much for joining me. It's great to have you. As always, if you happen to be a returning viewer, or welcome if you happen to be new here. This is another weekly talking, discussion, session type of video. And in this video, I am going to be somewhat analyzing a particular poem that kind of explains and draws attention to the simple fact that the English language is an absurd, horrible mess in total disrepair. I've done a couple of videos like this on my channel over the years, talking about just what I said, how the English language is broken and needs to be fixed. And obviously, I'm not the first one to be saying that. The poem that I'll be reading, I'm not sure if I'll be able to read the entire thing. It's quite lengthy, but we have about an hour, so who knows. It was written by, I'll try to pronounce the name the best I can, Gerard, middle name N-O-I-S-T, so Nolst, I don't know, and then Trenité, last name T-R-E-N-I-T-E, with a little accent over the E. And the poem is called The Chaos. And this was written in 1922. So 101 years ago, this poem was written, containing many irregularities, words that are often spelled the same or spelled differently, but either in the case where they're spelled the same, they have different sounds, or they're spelled similarly, they have different sounds, or they sound the same, spelled differently. So, like I said, it's a mess. And this is a prime example of why the English language needs to be fixed somehow, although I doubt it will ever happen. I was going to, in this video, I was going to provide my own examples, but then I remembered about this poem. The last time I did a video on this topic, someone put a link or mentioned the poem in one of the comments, and I happened to remember that while preparing to do this video. And I said, well, there's no point in me, you know, putting together my own examples when this poem pretty much puts the English language on blast. So I'm just going to go and read through as much as I can, and I'll kind of stop to explain some of the blatant or the obvious differences and examples as to why the English language is a mess, based on the, you know, the words themselves. So, without any further ado, why don't we get started? So again, this is the poem titled The Chaos, written in 1922, and most of the words in this poem have remained the same. I think there may have been a couple of words the spelling has changed, but for the most part, the English language, this poem, from a century ago, things still remain the same. So, again, I can't help but to say, do you know anything that is 100 years old, that is broken, and hasn't been fixed? Aside from, you know, things in, you know, po- politics and society, but, you know, in your own life, if you were to live, you know, for more, you know, for 200 years, would you be doing the same mistake over and over without fixing it? You know, it's kind of my point. All right, so here we go. I hope you're nice and comfortable. Oh, and there I'm going to try to put most of this in the description of this video so you can read along, but I'll also put a link in case you want to read along that way, and I'll post it on my website. And my website is safe and secure, so there's no ads or pop-ups or anything like that. All right, here we go. The chaos. Dearest creature in creation, studying English pronunciation, I will teach you in my verse. Sounds like corpse, core, horse, and worse. So right off the bat, we have a perfect prime example as to what's wrong with the English language. We have the word verse, V-E-R-S-E, and then we have the word horse and worse. Well, worse and verse are quite more similar sounding. Then we have corpse, V-E-R-S-E, verse, W-O-R-S-E, worse. All right, so there we go. How does it, now, why isn't it W-E-R-S-E? The other thing is we have corpse, C-O-R-P-S-E, and then we have core, C-O-R-P-S. So why? Why is there an E at the end of corpse? And then why is C-O-R-P-S not corpse, but core? Okay? It just, I'm going to try not to stop every, like, time I read one of these sentences because, but I mean, it's just, it's worth kind of analyzing and talking about. I will keep you, so let's continue. I will keep you, Susy, busy. Make your head with heat grow dizzy. So again, busy and dizzy sound the same, but spelled completely differently. B-U-S-Y is busy, and D-I-Z-Z-Y is dizzy. So, you know, why? Again, why do we have... It doesn't make sense. And head, H-E-A-D, and then the word H-E-A-T. It's not head and het. It's head and heat. Why? Again, in one of the previous videos I did about the English language, attempting to fix the English alphabet, I think I called it, I mentioned if you put a triangle and a circle and a square, those three shapes, those three symbols together, it's always circle, triangle, square. Well, that's what words, I mean, that's what letters are, symbols to represent sounds. Now, I know the English alphabet isn't phonetics, but again, maybe we should incorporate the English alphabet with the phonetic alphabet. It's just a thought. But again, when you have the symbols H-E-A-D for head and the symbols H-E-A-T for heat, you would think there would be some consistency on how they, you know, you look at them, and they should sound fairly similar, but they don't. It's heat, H-E-A-T, and not heed, H-E-A-D, but head. Heed is H-E-E-D. So if heed is H-E-E-D, why isn't heat H-E-E-T? Okay, let's continue. Pray, console your loving poet. Make my coat look new, dear, sew it. Just compare heart, hear, and heard. Dies and diet, Lord and word. So again, more examples. Heart, H-E-A-R-T, hear, H-E-A-R, and heard, H-E-A-R-D. all three words have the same root word, H-E-A-R, hear. But when you add a D at the end, it doesn't become heared, it becomes heard. And then when you add a T at the end of H-E-A-R, it's not heart, it's heart. I just can't with this. Okay, and then dies and diet, lord and word, L-O-R-D, lord, W-O-R-D, ward, no, word. Ward is actually W-A-R-D. Okay, let's continue. Sword and sward, retain and Britain, mind the latter, Britain, how it's written. Made has not the sound of bade. I thought B-A-D-E was bade, but maybe it's bid or bid. I don't really know. You have to forgive me. I'm not an expert on every single word. I always thought B-A-D-E was bade, but maybe it's bid. I don't really know. Anyway, all right, continuing. Say, said, pay, paid, laid, but not played. It's plaid. So it's kind of showing you there, though, when you go from say to said, right? Then you have pay and then paid. Then you have laid, L-A-I-D. But when you put a P in the front, it doesn't become played. It's plaid. Now, I surely will not plague you with such words as vague and ague. So again, the root word here, A-G-U-E, is ague or agru. I think it's ague. But when you put a V in the front, it's not vague, it becomes vague. So, and then P-L-A-G-U-E is plague. Okay, but be careful how you speak. Say the following: gush, bush, stake, streak, break, and bleak. So again, we have the root E-A-K. Remember, circle, triangle, square, when you put them side by side, it's always circle, triangle, square. So when you have the letters E-A-K side by side, that's eek or ache. You have to choose one, you would think, right? All right, so when you have E-A-K with an S-T in the front, it becomes steak. But when you have E-A-K with B-L in the front, it becomes bleak. Or S-T-R, streak. So, again, continuing. Previous, precious, fuchsia, via, recipe, pipe, studding sail, chair. So, previous, and then you have, you change the V in previous to a C. It's not precious, it's previous and precious. So why isn't it previous or previous? It's previous and precious, not precious. Woven, oven, how, and low. So again, that's a whole other discussion. The O-W sound, H-O-W is how, but L-O-W is low. And woven and oven, W. So you have the root O-V-E-N, which is oven. Put a W in front, it doesn't become woven. It's woven. So, and here's one other thing I want to interject. I don't understand why there isn't any consistency. That's the first thing. But what I really want to say is, it's not like there's a limited amount of letter combinations. So when some of these words, like tear and tear, they're spelled the same but have different meanings, why not just make a whole other word to represent tear, to to tear a page, or tear, as in to cry. Pick one of them, but make it a completely different word. Why are we using the same symbols, T-E-A-R, to not just pronounce it differently, but also to have a different meaning? Just use a whole new group of symbols. I don't know what the total number of letter word combinations are possible with the English alphabet. It's probably, you know, infinite, because you can just, you can put all kinds of letters together, you know, and maybe not even use vowels. So, you know, instead of, you know, let T-E-A-R be tear, like to tear a page, but maybe the tear becomes, I don't know, L-I-G-Q or something. You get what I'm saying? Just make it, everything should have its own unique set of symbols for, I mean, really, in my opinion. Okay, so let's continue. Script, receipt, shoe, poem, and toe. So again, the root O-E of toe is also in poem, P-O-E-M, and shoe, S-H-O-E. So why isn't the symbol combination O-E of toe, O-E-O, why isn't it poem? Now, sometimes people do say P-O-E-M as poem, but I think for the most part, we pronounce it as poem. But shoe, on the other hand, that's a better example of the O-E sound. T-O-E, toe, S-H-O-E, show, no, shoe. Again, you know, more examples of just the English language being absurd. Okay, let's continue. Say, expecting fraud and trickery, daughter, laughter, and terpsichore. I don't know what, if that's a name of a place, or probably, I don't think that's anybody's name, but this was daughter and laughter. Again, two more prime examples. The daughter and laughter is actually, was part of Gallagher, the comedian, rest in peace, part of his skit when I remember watching him back in like the 80s, and he went over the whole daughter laughter, and he did something similar in this vein. But yeah, D-A-U-G-H-T-E-R, daughter, but then all you do is change the D to an L, and it's not lauder, it's laughter. So, again, more absurd inconsistency. Doesn't make sense. Branch, ranch. Okay, so far that's good. Measles, topsails, aisles, missiles, similes, and reviles. So, this part of the poem is about, I guess, the sound and combination of words with I-L-E-S in them. So we have measles, which is M-E-A-S-L-E-S. And then we have topsails, S-A-I-L-S. And then we have aisles. So A-I-S-L-E-S is aisles. I mean, you look at that word, A-I-S-L. You would think maybe it's azels, right, or something. And then we have missiles, M-I-S-S-I-L-E-S. Similes, so S-I-M-I-L-E-S. Similes. And then reviles, R-E-V-I-L-E-S. So the last three words or a better example, you have I-L-E-S in missiles, but then when you put S-I-M in front, it becomes similes. So I-L-S goes from ills of missiles to illies in similes, and then isles in reviles. But then we have A-I-S-L-E-S also is isles. So we have I-L-E-S in reviles is isles. And then we have A-I-S-L-E-S is isles. So again, more example. Okay, continuing. Holy, holly, signal, and signing. So again, S-I-G-N. A-L is signal, and you say the G and the N in that word, signal. But when you take S-I-G-N and put I-N-G at the end, it doesn't become signing, it becomes signing. So, and the root word of signing is S-I-G-N, which is sign. So, why is S-I-G-N sign? But when you have S-I-G-N-A-L, it's not signal, it's signal. Then we have same, examining, but mining. So E-X-A-M-I-N-I-N-G is not examining, it's examining. But yet M-I-N-I-G by itself is not mining, it's mining. And then we have scholar, vicar, and cigar. Solar, mica, I think, M-I-C-A, I think is mica. War, and far. So again, this is more about the A-R combination. We have vicar, V-I-C-A-R, vicar. Not vicar or vicar. Well, it can be vicar or vicar, but it's that E-R sound. And then you have C-I-G-A-R. So that's cigar. So why isn't V-I-C-A-R vicar? But it's not. And then you have solar. So again, the E-R, S-O-L-A-R. Not solar, like cigar. No, it's solar, like vicar. So why isn't there an E in there, right? Usually E-R is er. And then we have war, W-A-R, and far, F-A-R. Now, cigar and far, those are similar sounding, so that's appropriate. That's correct. But why isn't W-A-R war, like far, W-A-R war? No, it's war. So, that doesn't make any sense. Next, continuing with the poem, we have from desire. Desirable, admirable, from admire. Lumber, plumber, beer, but I'm not really sure about these next few words. We have B-I-E-R. I'm not really familiar with that word. And then we have B-R-I-E-R. And I'm not too familiar with that one. But forget about those two words. We have lumber, L-U-M-B-E-R, and P-L-U-M-B-E-R. Plumber. No, it's plumber. So why the B in plumber? Why not just one M or two M's? I mean, you only need one M. M makes the M sound. So plumber, P-L-U-M-E-R, right? Simple, concise, to the point. No, let's put a B in there that we're never going to pronounce. Now again, I understand some of these words come from older English or whatever. So there's some carryover in regards to letters that probably shouldn't be there anymore. Well, that's the point. This is 2023, not 1920, 22, not the 1700s. All right? So just fix the damn English language. Somebody, please. I mean, how many poems and videos do we have to make? Now, granted, there's a lot of things worse off in the world that need to be fixed. But you only need a few people dedicated to, you know, some scholars, right? To take a weekend and just make all these corrections, right? A couple hours on a Saturday. Okay, continuing, Topsham, I don't know, which might be a city or town. I'm thinking some of these proper words, I'm thinking maybe are based on where this poet or this writer lived, you know, something like that, making references to well-known cities or towns. Topsham, Brougham, I think, B-R-O-U-G-H-A-M. You know, some of these words, it's possible, are no longer in use. Renown, but known. Knowledge, done. Loan, gone. None, and tone. So here is another example of the own type of sound. We have renown, R-E-N-O-W-N, but K-N-O-W-N is known. So is O-W-N the own sound, or is it the own sound? I mean, can we just pick one? That's really the whole point. Remember, circle, triangle, square, always circle, triangle, square, as far as pronunciation goes. When you see a circle, a triangle, and a square, you don't say square, square, triangle. When you see a circle, it's a circle. When you see a triangle, it's a triangle. When you see a square, it's a square, right? So it's the same type of, you know, logic that should be applied to the English language and the alphabet. But again, we have the O-N-E sound, D-O-N-E, done. L-O-N-E, lun, no, lone. G-O-N-E, gone or gun, no, gone. N-O-N-E is none. So that's similar to D-O-N-E. So we have some consistency there in two words. And then we have T-O-N-E, tone, which is similar to L-O-N-E, loan. So there are some consistencies among the inconsistencies. D-O-N-E, done. N-O-N-E, none, but L-O-N-E is not lun, and T-O-N-E is not ton. They're loan and tone. Yet, and then we have gone, G-O-N-E. Now there's the word lawn, L-A-W-N. So when you look at lawn, L-A-W-N, and you look at G-O-N-E, and you're saying gone for that word too. Two words that are totally spelled different, yet same pronunciation. Okay, let's continue. One, anemone, balmoral. Kitchen, lichen, laundry, and laurel. So again, one, O-N-E, that was part of the previous stance in the poem. O-N-E is not only un of done, but it's also own of loan and tone, and, one of done and none. Right, so O-N-E by itself is one. But you would think it should be own. But actually, O-W-N is own. kitchen, lichen, laundry, laurel. So there's kitchen and lichen. K-I-T-C-H-E-N, kitchen. L-I-C-H-E-N. Lichen? Lichen? No. Lichen. As in L-I-K-E-N. Lichen. All right, let's continue. Gertrude, German, wind, and wind. So there is another perfect example. Wind, the same word, W-I-N-D, pronounced differently, like tear and tear. Wind and wind. Why? You should not have a word, a group of symbols that are exactly the same that sound differently. So you got to change wind and wind. One of them has to be spelled differently or made up of the word itself to represent a different meaning. It should have a totally different group of symbols and letters. Okay, continuing, we have bow, B-E-A-O, kind, kindred, Q, mankind, tortoise, turquoise, and chamoy, leather. I think that's C-H-A-M-O-I. Is that, I should know how to pronounce that. I hear it sometimes. I don't really use it that often. It's not chamois, it's chamoy, isn't it? Something like that. All right, but forget that word. Chamois, I don't know, whatever, leather. But we have tortoise and turquoise. T-O-R-T-O-I-S-E, tortoise. But then you have T-U-R-Q-U-O-I-S-E. It's not Turkish. It's turquoise. So it's not tortoise, it's tortoise. So we have T-O-R-T-O-I-S-E, right? Tortoise instead of tortoise, which you would think because you have turquoise. Okay. Then we have reading and reading, or we have reading and reading. Either way, we have reading, as in reading a book, and then we have the place known as Reading. So who knows which one was meant to be, you know, when you're reading this, you don't know which one he meant to be the place. Is it Reading and then Reading, or Reading and then Reading? So that's a whole other problem in its entirety. Are proper names proper names that you can pronounce them however you want. It's like as soon as a name becomes proper, like a person's name or the name of a place, it just throws all logic out the window. I mean, it's bad enough there's not a lot of logic to begin with when it comes to the English language. But when it comes to proper names, I mean, that's where you just put any kind of letters together and say it however you want. Okay, then we have heathen and heather. So again, the only difference between heathen and heather, both are spelled H-E-A-T-H-E, but one has the N at the end, heathen, and one has the R at the end, heather. Why? They shouldn't even be, they should either sound the same or different spellings or whatever. Okay. This phonetic labyrinth, which is a great statement, gives moss, gross, brook, brooch, ninth, and plinth, or plinth. I don't use P-L-I-N-T-H or hear it or see it that often, so that might be plinth. So again, M-O-S-S, moss. G-R-O-S-S, gross. No, gross. So then we have B-R-O-O-K, brook. B-R-O-O-C-H, brooch. No, brooch. Okay, let's continue. Have you ever yet endeavored to pronounce revered and severed? So there's endeavored. Endeavored is a ridiculously elaborately spelled word. ENDEAVOURED, endeavored. And then you have REVERED, revered? No, revered. Okay, so if it's revered, then what is SEVERED? Severed? No, severed. So if EVERED is evered, so why have endeavored spelled so elaborately? ENDEAVOR. It's just too many. Just call it, just spell it ENDEVERED. Endeavored. Okay. Continuing. Demon, lemon, ghoul, foul, soul, Peter, petrol, and patrol. So again, here's a combination. You have E-M-O-N of demon, but change it to an L, and it's not lemon, it's lemon. And then we have O-U-L, ghoul, put an F in the front, foul, and put an S in the front, soul. So O-U-L, those three symbols, right, you would think would sound the same. But with G-H in the front, it's ghoul. F-O-U-L, foul. S-O-U-L, soul. So again, craziness. Peter, petrol, and patrol. Another example. Billet, B-I-L-L-E-T. I don't see that word that often. I'm assuming it's billet. Does not end like ballet, right? Bouquet, wallet, mallet, and chalet. So again, another examples. W-A-L-L-E-T, wallet. M-A-L-L-E-T, mallet? No, mallet. So if it's, so it should be, so should wallet be wallet, or should mallet be mollet? Then it continues. Blood and flood are not like food, nor is mold like should and would. So again, these are the OOD and the OULD, another great combination. So we have BLOOD and FLOOD, blood and flood. Okay, those are consistent sounding, so that's probably the way OOD should be pronounced. So put an F in the front. F-O-O-D. Is that FUD? Like flood? No, it's food. So is O-O-D supposed to be OOD or UD? Now, if it's supposed to be OOD, so then F-L-O-O-D wouldn't be flood. It would be flood. And B-L-O-O-D, that runs in our veins, is no longer blood, but blued. So can we just pick one? OOD, just make it sound, be consistent, one sound, okay? And that way, oh no, so maybe we should change BLOOD to blued. Oh no, I'm blooding. And have you given any blued today? Okay. And then we have OULD, should and would. So those are similar sounding. And then we have mold. M-O-U-L-D. Now that might be an old English word, M-O-U-L-D. I know mold is also, or is, M-O-L-D. So that could be like an outdated spelling. I don't know. I don't really come across the word M-O-U-L-D that often. Okay, continuing. Banquet is not nearly, I'm not sure how to pronounce this. P-A-R-Q-U-E-T. I want to say parquet. Not quite sure. Which exactly rhymes with khaki. So maybe it's parky. I don't know. Discount, viscount, load, and broad. Toward, to forward, to reward. So there we have D-I-S-C-O-U-N-T, discount. But then when it comes to V-I-S-C-O-U-N-T, it's not viscount, it's viscount. We don't say the S. And then we have O-A-D, L-O-A-D, load. But change it to B-R-O-A-D, and it becomes not broad, but broad. And then we have toward, and forward, and reward. So T-O-W-A-R-D is toward. We don't say the O. But then we have F-O-R-W-A-R-D, and we say forward. So that's kind of similar sounding, but just a little inconsistency. We're not saying toward, we're saying toward. So why the O? And then we have reward. So, you know, a little consistency there, but, you know, again, not so much. Moving on, we have ricocheted and crocheting croquet. Right, your pronunciation's okay. So again, R-I-C-O-C-H-E-T-E-D is ricocheted. And then you have C-R-O-C-H-E-T-I-N-G, crocheting. And then C-R-O-Q-U-E-T, croquet. So, rounded, wounded, grieve, and sieve, friend and fiend, alive and live. So again, we can take a look at grieve and sieve. I-E-V-E in both words. G-R-I-E-V-E is grieve. S-I-E-V-E is not sieve, it's sieve. Then we have friend and fiend. I-E-N-D is the root for both words. So, F-R-I-E-N-D is friend. Okay, so F-I-E-N-D, take away the R. Is it fend? No, it's fiend. So if it's fiend, why isn't it friend instead of friend? And then we have alive and live. The only difference is that there is an A in front of live. So it's not a live. It's alive. Now, when it comes to live, we do have live, as in that is a live show. So I'm not sure if live had that kind of part of speech, right? You have verb and noun and adverb, etc. So we have live and live. Now, I'm not sure, you know, which I'm not an expert when it comes to, and that's grammar, right? Or parts of speech. Anyway. When the poem was written, most likely we have friend and fiend, alive and live. I'm not sure if they meant to say alive and live. Either way, we know that L-I-V-E has two different pronunciations, live and live. And that doesn't make sense. Again, it's like tear and tear, or wind and wind. Just spell it completely different. It has a different meaning, so it shouldn't have the same group of symbols. All right, continuing. We are about halfway through. I'm not going to finish the whole thing. Let's see if I can just skip here a little bit. Here we go. Would it tally with my rhyme if I mentioned paradigm? So another example, R-H-Y-M-E, rhyme. Sounds like a too many... trying to overcomplicate things to make it look smart. Just spell it R-I-M-E. That's rhyme. You know, get rid of this R-H-Y-M-E nonsense. It's like the word endeavor. Nolst Trenité. It's like somebody, I feel like sometimes, you know, somebody was trying to write these words as if, you know, look at me, how I can spell endeavor. I'm so smart. Nolst Trenité. You know, I mean, you could, you know, look at me, QWXPTYVNGHOOQMILEAEPJKWXXTUM, and that means penny. All right, but I think you get my point. So rhyme and paradigm, right? P-A-R-A-D-I-G-M. I-G-M is, makes the I'm sound, and so does Y-M-E. How does I-G-M make the I'm sound? It should be like IGM. All right, and then we have 2p, 3p. Okay, it's not bad. Tease and easy. Okay, so far so good. But cease, crease, grease, and greasy. All right, so T-E, so this is making, poking fun at the E-A-S and the E-A-S-E combination. So T-E-A-S-E, tease. E-A-S-Y, easy. Okay, so far so good. And then we have C-E-A-S-E, no different than T-E-A-S-E. So, T's and C's, no. C-E-A-S-E is cease. And then we have C-R-E-A-S-E, is that crease, like T's? No, it's crease, like cease. And then we have G-R-E-A-S-E. Is that grease, like tease? No, it's grease, like cease. And then we have G-R-E-A-S-Y, okay? Is that greasy? No, it's greasy. So we have E-A-S-Y is easy. But when you add a G-R in the front, it becomes greasy, not greasy. Moving on, I'm just going to skip around here a little bit. Getting towards the end. Let's see. Actually, I'm not even halfway. I'm probably just about a quarter of the way through. This poem is so well written and has so many great examples. I would probably be here for 3 hours trying to diagnose and analyze it. Let's go to another example. Liberty, library, heave and heaven, Rachel, lock, mustache, 11. So there we have the E-A-V-E and the E-V-E-N type of spelling and sound. H-E-A-V-E is heave, but when they add an N to the end, it's not heaven, it's heaven. Just like E-L-E-V-E-N is 11. So, we say hallowed, but allowed. People, leopard, toad, but vowed. So again, making fun of the O-W-E sound or spelling. T-O-W-E-D is toad, but change the T to a V. It's not vowed, it's vowed. Okay, skipping around here, we have desert but dessert, or dessert but desert. So again, same spelling, same exact spelling, but two different meanings and two different pronunciations. That's just bad. Then we have golf and wolf. I'm just going to point out, basically, I'm not even going to read at this point, read too much the rest of the poem, but just kind of point out the words here. G-O-L-F, golf. W-O-L-F, wolf. No, it's wolf. So if it's wolf, why isn't G-O-L-F golf? So, again, we have tomb, bomb, and comb. T-O-M-B. This is another, I think, part from the comedian Gallagher's skit. I think I remember this combination. So, the same letter combo, O-M-B. Put a T in the front, it's tomb. Put a B in the front, it's bomb. Put a C in the front, it's comb. So, and om. That's pretty much the different sounds those three symbols make. O-M-B. Oh, boy. Okay. And then we have solder and soldier. S-O-L-D-E-R to solder. Solder, like pipe to weld. And then we have soldier. S-O-L-D-I-E-R. Blood is thicker. Quoth he, than liqueur or liquor. So, L-I-Q-U-O-R is liquor, and T-H-I-C-K-E-R is thicker. Let's see, what else do we have here? Okay, another example, gooseberry, goose, and close. But close, or gooseberry goose and close, but close. And who really knows? You know, it's kind of hard to exactly tell which pronunciation, which word was meant to be said here when you're reading this poem. Anyway, gooseberry goose and close, but close. Paradise, rise, rose, and dose. So again, that's the O-S-E combination. D-O-S-E, dose. C-L-O-S-E, well, can be close, but is also close, as in close the door. And then we have R-O-S-E, as in rose, but not rose. So, dose is not doze, like close, it's dose. And R-O-S-E is not rose, but rose. So, just more examples. What else do we have here? Oh, and speaking of, I think they said goose. That's another thing when it comes to the singular and plural form of certain words. That's a whole discussion as well. For instance, some words we just slap an S at the end. So when I hold up my one finger, that's a finger. When I hold up all four, those are fingers. Right? It's not finger and finger, like goose and geese. So it's not one goose. So one type of bird is that looks like a goose is a goose. When you have multiple goose, it's geese, not gooses. So in some words, for some reason, we change the O-O to an E-E. But not all words, like when it comes to sheep. The singular of sheep is sheep. The plural of sheep is sheep. So if we're following like goose and geese, shouldn't there be shoop and sheep? I mean, that makes sense to me. One sheep is a shoop. I know it sounds funny now, but you gotta have some consistency. You can't just, you know, what if we said all types of goose were geese? Oh, that's one geese. And those are all geese. No, it's, oh, that's a goose, that's a geese, but those are all sheep. Even one sheep is a sheep. And then sometimes we just add the letter S at the end. It's like, that's one wall. Well, what are multiple? Well, it's not wheels. It's walls. Well, that's one rat. Well, that's multiple rat is rats. It's not rat and then reet. Then we have mice. Then I think we have meese or mices. I'm not sure. I think meese is a word, right? No, I'm sorry. It's mouse, and then not meese, but mice. And some words, we just change it completely, like mouse. Think about that. M-O-U-S-E. But multiple mouse are M-I-C-E. You go completely. So why isn't one goose a geese? Right? You have mouse and mice, louse and lice. But goose doesn't become geese, becomes geese. So why not mouse and meese? I just can't. It's just, so, I mean, really. Okay, couple more examples, and then we'll, you know, get to the end of the video. Another section from the poem here. Stranger does not rhyme with anger. Again, A-N-G-E-R. With the S-T-R in the front, it becomes not stranger, but stranger. However, when you put an L after the G, it becomes strangler. So it goes from stranger to not strangler, but strangler. So it should be stranger or stranger, like anger. But it's not. Neither does devour with clangor. So D-E-V-O-U-R is a devour. But C-L-A-N-G-O-U-R is not clangour, it's clangor, or clangor, whatever. And then we have pilot, pivot, gaunt, but ant. So G-A-U-N-T is not gant, it's gaunt. So A-U-N-T is aunt. No, it's ant. So why the U? If it's ant, A-U-N-T, then just make it A-N-T. But no, we can't, because A-N-T is an insect. Small little bug. Ant. Aye, aye, aye. And then we have font, front, want, grand, and grant. So W-O-N-T, not the W-O-N apostrophe T, not won't, but W-O-N-T is want. I don't see or use that word that often. But I think the point here is that W-O-N-T and W-A-N-T sound the same. But we also have F-O-N-T, which is font. But put an R after the F, it's not front. Font and front. No, it's front. So if it's front, why isn't it F-R-U-N-T? I just can't. So many, I mean, really, you just, I don't even, you know, whenever somebody says, we really should just always point to this poem, whenever somebody questions the English language, there's no need to have a discussion, a panel, a group, or, you know, just say, read this poem, and this will explain to you everything that's wrong with the English language, not just the fact that there's a lot of examples in here, but also the fact that this poem is 101 years old as of the date of this video, 2023, and nothing has changed. I mean, who knows how much older some of these words are. They could be 200-300 years old or older. And here we are, in quote-unquote modern society, right? We are the advanced, most advanced species on the planet. But yet, one of our languages that we speak, the English language, is so utterly broken and absurd that it you know, really advanced. And you have words that, simple words, W-I-N-D, you're advanced. But that word, W-I-N-D, not only is pronounced differently, but has different meanings. You know, those four symbols, W-I-N-D, wind, but it's also wind. And just like tear and tear. Oh, we're so advanced. But, yeah, but, okay, sure. I mean, it's just, I mean, this poem is so long. So many great examples in here. Here's another one. Shoes, goes, does. Now first say finger, then say singer, ginger, and linger. Real, zeal, mauve, gauze, and gauge. Marriage, foliage, mirage, and age. So more great examples. I mean, finger, F-I-N-G-E-R, but G-I-N-G-E-R is not ginger, it's ginger. And then S-I-N-G-E-R is not singer, it's singer. Let me see. Gauze, G-A-U-Z-E, and G-A-U-G-E. Gauze and not gauge, but gauze and gauge. So why is there a U in gauge? Just make it G-A-G-E. That's gauge. And then we have foliage, F-O-L-I-A-G-E, and M-I-R-A-G-E. Foliage and mirage. No, it's foliage and mirage. So A-G-E by itself is age, not age, age. So if A-G-E is age, why isn't M-I-R-A-G-E mirage? It's not. It's mirage. Why not just spell it M-I-R-A-J? J is the J, J type of sound. So mirage. All right. Well, I think we've been here long enough. And like I said, I mean, it would probably take me 2-3 hours to really analyze and go through all this, especially in this more relaxed format. If I was trying to speak normally and more loudly and quickly, I could probably do it less time, but I prefer this format, and I think you might too. Anyway, so that's going to do it. So again, a prime example as to why the English language is a mess and it's broken, and you know, who knows, it will ever be fixed. But yeah, it's just ugly. It's pretty sad. But that's English, and I'm sure other languages are probably have some inconsistencies, and you know, maybe not. Maybe there are some better alternatives out there. You know, and who knows? Maybe one of these days, you know, we'll fix all these words and change them appropriately. And then, I mean, that's all you have to do. Us, you know, folks that have learned a certain word that's spelled the same, will take us time to adjust. But when you make the changes, say wind and wind, change one of them to be spelled completely different. And when you teach it to the new generation, for them, they'll remember it, and it'll be easy for them. And as you go forward, every generation after will finally have a fixed and more consistent, logical language to use. One that has very little inconsistencies and fallacies and irregularities and such. So, and that's going to do it. So, thanks for joining me. And again, I hope you had a chance to, you know, check out this poem. It's a great example. And surely just to, if you haven't seen it before, you know, share it around. I'm sure a lot of folks will just have, I mean, I don't even know how some of the words are pronounced. Some of them might be older, but yeah, you might have fun with family members or friends or whoever trying to read this and seeing exactly. And this was 100 years ago, you know, and someone, and I'm sure the person that wrote this isn't the only one either, that, you know, so there's a lot of folks that see the English language as a horrible mess, all right? And that's going to do it. So again, Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for joining me. It was great to have you. Whether you are a returning or a new viewer or subscriber. And stay tuned for another weekly episode that gets published every Tuesday. And let's see, I think this is going out this is the 25th of April, 2023. So next week will be the beginning of May, May 1st or May 2nd, I believe. The next episode after this, so another true story time. Maybe I'll talk about how I was a altar boy once, or how I was shot between the eyes once. I don't know. I'll figure something to talk about, a little anecdote, and kind of analyze and discuss the human psychosis and all that. So until then, I wish you all my best. Stay well. Stay safe, and I hope to see you in another video real soon. So long, and take care for now. All right, let's just read a little bit more of this here. Pudding, puddle, putting, putting. Yes, at golf it rhymes with shutting. Respite, spite, consent, resent, liable, but parliament. Seven is right, but so is even. Hyphen, roughen, nephew, Stephen. Monkey, donkey, clerk, and jerk. Asp, grasp, wasp. Demence, demesne. I'm not sure about that word. Cork, and work. So there's jerk, J-E-R-K. Work, W-O-R-K. A of valor, vapid and vapor. S of news, compared newspaper. G of gibbet, gibbon, and gist. I of antichrist and grist. Differ, like diverse and divers. Rivers, strivers, shivers, and fivers. Once, but nunce. Toll, doll, but roll. Polish, Polish, pole, and pall. Pronunciation, think of psyche. Is a paling, stout, and spiky. Won't it make you lose your wits? Writing groats and saying grits. I guess G-R-O-A-T-S is also pronounced grits. It's a dark abyss or tunnel, strewn with stones like Rolick and Gunwell. Islington and Isle of Wight, housewife, verdict, and indict. Don't you think so, reader, rather? Sing, lather, bather, and father. More examples of A-T-H-E-R. Finally, which rhymes with enough, though, through, bow, cough, ho. I'm not sure how to pronounce H-O-U-G-H. Maybe how or ho. So and tough. So again, more examples of the O-U-G-H combination. Sometimes it's through, sometimes it's cough. So though, through, bow, cough, so, and tough. Hiccup has the sound of sup. My advice is give it up.